So when I started thinking about the symposium, I wanted to, well, it quite quickly evolved to, let's do a spectral experiment in a day. And what do we start with? We have to start by thinking about what reagents we would need, what reagents are out there to enable us to do spectral. And over the years, I've spoken at many thermo events with Seddon, and when they told me that they were going to fly it over, I was absolutely delighted, because you're an amazing speaker about reagents, and so I'm really happy that you're here today. Thank you very much, Seddon.
So, as we, you know, think about dyes and, you know, how that's tied into hardware innovation, I think this is a really good...
What?
Oh! I'm going to introduce a lot more bingos as we go, so we'll see what's, how that goes. But if you think about, you know, when we first started out with the Fax Caliber, you know, there's really not a lot of pressure on dye development. So, you know, you've got the four-color system, you pretty much FITSE, PE, PER-CP, APC, so pretty simple in terms of dyes, a lot more dyes out there than, you know, instruments that can actually take advantage of them. And then over time, as we're moving from the Fax Caliber to the 12-color Fax Vantage, the 18-color LSR2, the Fax Symphony, and now into spectral instruments like the Sony ID7000, the Bigfoot Spectral Sorter, and the Aurora. You know, there's really a lot of pressure. So, you know, there's a lot more pressure on the different dye performance at this point. So really moving to these higher parameters really changes how we start to look at the dyes that are available. And so one place that I like to start is really kind of where we were trained and where spectral is really showing us some of the issues underlying, you know, how we're even thinking about what's happening here. So this is looking at APC. You can see here you've got the excitation curve, you've got the emission curve for APC. We're all used to looking at this dye. And what this would tell you is that, you know, primarily it's going to be excited by the red laser, and then you would expect to see some cross-excitation from the yellow-green laser. But what spectral cytometry is really telling us is a slightly different story, but the dye hasn't changed. So you can see here that you do have, again, the primary excitation for APC coming off the red laser, and indeed see this cross-excitation from the yellow-green. But what's not necessarily there is what you see coming off of the UV and the violet, and even into the blue. And so this is part of what's happening in terms of dye performance that we're not necessarily used to thinking about, but really underlies a lot of our panel design. And so, you know, when you think about, we used to have rules, you know, on a conventional instrument saying, okay, if you have more than a certain number of BVs, you start to have issues with some of the dyes coming off the yellow-green. And so a lot of that that's sort of been passed on is really being spelled out more clearly when you look at these spectra. So even when people are looking at a conventional instrument, I encourage them to look at these spectra to really understand what's happening with their dye and how some of this performance can affect their experiments. And so when you look at, you know, a dye signature, it's really the result of non-ideal dye performance, and we can use this for phenotyping, but it does affect your experiment. So you can see here you've got APC and Alexaflor 647. And so on the Aurora, you have R1 is the primary channel for APC, R2 is the primary channel for Alexaflor 647, but that's not really how they're being distinguished. So when you look at this, you can see that really a lot of their differences are coming off of the UV laser and the violet laser. And so while this does increase the theoretical limit of the colors in the panel, it also contributes to the spread and background that you might see as you're doing your experiment. And so, you know, we try to step back from this and say, okay, you know, how does conventional dye performance affect your panel design? And conventional dyes can really only perform in two ways, and both can lead to spread or loss of data resolution. And so you can look at a dye like UV510. It's great in that it's not cross-excited, but it is taking up a fair amount of spectral space in terms of this broader emission. And then there are dyes like PE, PE Dazzle, PerCP, that are have this cross-excitation from both the blue and the yellow-green lasers. And so again, taking up space that, you know, is real estate that you might want to use in your spectral experiments. And so on top of that, you have issues with spillover and data resolution. So, you know, here this is looking at APC and PE size 7, just showing the overall spectra. And then if you're looking at a single color control with APC size 7, you can see this is, you know, what it would look like in its uncompensated form. So it looks like you have a double positive. And in our minds, again, this is what we'd like to see, that, you know, you basically could compensate that. There would be no issues in terms of signal into PE size 7. And I've even had people say, well, how do I make this my data look like this? And the answer is you can't. It's just an issue of dye performance. And so when you think about the reality of that situation, you know, there's APC size 7 that's acting as the perpetrator and PE size 7 as the victim. And so when you look at this spillover spreading error, you can see that if you were distinguishing something really bright, you don't really have an issue. You can see what your populations are. It's pretty clear. But when you're looking at something dimmer, you can see that it would get to be harder and harder to understand what that is. And that's just with one color. So you can imagine as you build out to a bigger and bigger panel, this can continue to be an issue. And so, you know, we tried to ask the question of, like, what would an ideal dye look like? And so this is an imaginary dye called Perfect Blue. It's, you know, great in that it's showing up in only one detector. It's not cross-excited. And it's also breaking some of the laws of physics. So the real goal would be to generate something a tad less than perfect blue. So having, you know, the peak in one of the 64 channels of the aurora, and then having this rapid decline so that you're not taking up a lot of your spectral space. And so, you know, if you could design a label from scratch, you know, how would that change your panel design? And so you'd want it to ideally be bright and clean, really limit laser cross-excitation. You'd want it to be consistent and stable so that when you're doing your experiments, especially like a longitudinal study, that there's no real change in the fluorescence. And if you could match brightness to what antigen density you have, so matching something, say, brighter to something that's less expressed and vice versa. And so that's what we tried to do with the Phyton technology. And so what this is the technology underlying the NovaFluors. So you can see here we have a donor and acceptor dyes, and these are at specific positions along the DNA. And then this whole structure can actually be folded, will fold itself into this Phyton structure, which is this cruciform structure. And what you can see is that it's able to use FRET to basically have the fluorescence that we can engineer the excitation and emission. So the chemists actually are able to position, you know, even change this, say, by +2, 0, -2 to really get into those distances to make sure that we have the excitation and emission that we want. And then we can also build to more brightness by design. We haven't focused on that as much. So in general, we have this 2-cluster version, but we can build to greater brightness with this platform. And so, you know, it's a good platform in that it can allow us to really have that stable place. So it's works similarly to tandems in that it's taking advantage of FRET, but it's different in that we're controlling how much is on every structure of the Phyton. And so these are the NovaFluor dyes that we've released at this point. You can see we have NovaFluor blue, which means that it's excited primarily by the blue laser and not so much by the other lasers. And then if you're looking at this, the emission would be around 510 nanometers. And so we've really tried to target spectral as we're building this out. So some of these are spaced closer together than you might be used to on a conventional instrument. And then we do have for NovaFluor Blue 610 a dimmer version and a brighter version of these dyes. And in spectral, they can be distinguished, but I'm not sure that necessarily putting those like together would be your best option in a spectral panel, but you can match that, and the same thing for NovaFluorBlue 660. We have the dimmer and the brighter version referring to the separation index. In addition, we've just released four new NovaFluor dyes as we're pushing into the red. So we have NovaFluorBlue 690 that was released in September, and then NovaFluorYellow 755. NovaFluor Red 725 and 755 that have released this month. So we're continuing to push into the red, and I'll talk a little bit about, you know, what the challenges are as you start to build dyes into that part of the spectrum. We have not, however, released anything in the UV and the violet. This continues to be purple rain, so the goal, but we're not there yet. But in the meantime, we do have the BUVs and BV dyes licensed and are selling antibodies conjugated with those to help build out your panels. And so one more slide specifically talking about the conjugates that we have. So we actually have all of these conjugates in all 23 colors available. And then we have, just as of last month, built to 100 NovaFluor conjugated clones in the multiple colors to allow for easier panel design. So if we didn't have the clone you wanted, you might want to recheck the website just to see if that's available at this point. And so in terms of talking about targeted approaches to fluorescent label design, I'm going to talk about three things that we've really tried to target. So separating blue and yellow-green excitation as compared to existing PE and PE tandems, building to longer Stokes shift, and understanding how the cytometer laser power and available detectors affect dye performance. And so switching to a different instrument, this is data coming from the 7-laser Bigfoot. In the reagent space, we really want to build to every cytometer out there. So we're looking forward to being able to also run our dyes on Sony ID7000. You can see here, we've got PE, and you can see this is the 7-laser spectrum. And you can, again, see this cross-excitation from both the blue and the yellow-green lasers. To try to address that problem, you can see here, this is showing you NovaFluor Yellow 570. And so you can see that it's excited by the yellow laser, but not so much by the blue laser. And we have here NovaFluor Blue 585 that's excited by the blue laser and not so much by the yellow laser. So this really gives you a two-for-one situation in terms of conventional, but it also allows you some more space in your panel as you're building into spectral, because you're not basically taking up those two spaces. And again, even if you can unmix the dyes, you do start to build up the background, and so that becomes an issue when you're building out your panel. And so just to show you here, these are the NovaFluor dyes, again, that we have so far. So we have a number of these with the blue, yellow-green split to be able to address that, and we're continuing to build out into the spectrum. And so the next thing to sort of look at was, you know, the challenge of building to more red-shifted dyes. And so, you know, thinking about longer Stokes shift from the primary defined laser. So you can see here, here's an example where your typical situation of your, say, you know, PE tandem dyes. So you have your donor, it's got the primary laser line excitation. You have, you know, this high spectral overlap. Then the acceptor dye can take up that signal, and hopefully you've got as much transfer as possible to get basically this to, you know, produce the shift that you want. But what about a different situation? What about when you have, you know, a donor, and then you've gone on and you're trying to get far enough out in the spectrum that your acceptor A doesn't have really any overlap, it's got issues with cross excitation. You know, how do we get that far out in the spectrum? And this isn't, you know, really just a hypothetical problem. You can see here, this is just showing on the Aurora that, you know, taking just a sort of snapshot from a panel, you can see that there's a gap between R4 and R8, and there's another gap between YG5 and YG9. And when you look even at, say, something like BL11 through 14, you'll just see that there's an absence of dyes. And so there's a real need to have new dyes as we're building into the spectral space. And again, as I've been speaking in Europe, this is not necessarily the best analogy, American football, but I think you can get the idea here. Just to think about, you know, the challenges. If you think about, you know, throwing to someone at a short distance, you know, it's not so hard to get that short distance. Someone can catch it. That doesn't take a lot of skill. But, you know, if you're trying to throw that longer distance, you need precision to be able to get there. You need a lot of energy to throw that across the spectrum, and you need something that can receive that properly. And so that's really the challenge of getting, you know, from this donor to the acceptor. So it's really a long distance across the spectrum. Cross-excitation can be an issue, and the acceptor is larger and more unstable and thus susceptible to oxidation. So there are a number of issues there as you build to these farther parts of the spectrum, and so that's one of the challenges that we've tried to address. And so, as I mentioned, building out these new dyes, I've just highlighted them, and this is showing you on an aurora layout, you know, where you can see the emission and then the different lasers here. You can see that we have NovaFluor Blue 690 and NovaFluor Yellow 755. And, you know, we can actually generate these dyes fairly quickly, but the question is always, do we enable it? Does it have less cross-excitation? Does it have less spread? You know, how does it help you in building out your panel? And so you can see here with NovaFluor Blue 690, again, PerCP Sci 5.5 does have this cross-excitation here. So now you can have this more limited issue in terms of the cross-excitation. And the same thing here with NovaFluor Yellow 755. You can see here that although we list PE Psi 7 coming off the yellow green laser, it is again cross-excited by the blue laser. Additionally, these other two dyes that we're listing here are filling out parts that we really did not at ThermoFisher have dyes that address. So we have Nova Red 725 and Nova Red 755. And so in that case, we're trying to fill out parts of the spectrum. And so you can see the overall, you know, plan of what we'd like to attack is really doing that for, you know, this instrument and other instruments, you know, building out dyes and parts of the spectrum that don't actually have something available there. And so shifting gears once again, I think it's an important question to really understand how dye performance is related to the instrument configuration. And so you can see here on the Aurora, you have a 20 milliwatt laser coming off of the UV and a 100 milliwatt laser for the violet. And then you've got a number of other lasers here. These are just, I went through and sort of listed off some ranges of lasers on typical instruments just to have a comparison. And, you know, on the Aurora, you're using APDs. On a number of other instruments like the Bigfoot, you're using PMTs. So you can see here that on APDs, it will detect better in the red. PMTs will tend to detect better in the UV and the violet, and that's just part of their physics. If anyone was there for my cyto talk, someone asked me to explain that in great detail, and I'm not going to go into the physics of that, but you can get better performing of those on various, you know, you can get sort of increased PMTs, et cetera, on some of these instruments, but that's just the basic physics of how these detect the fluors. And so when you look at something like the Bigfoot spectral cell sorter, you can see here these have 100 milliwatt lasers coming off here. But one of the interesting challenges as, you know, we were coming into looking at this was, okay, how does the 445 laser affect what we're seeing in terms of trying to design dyes to limit cross-excitation and spread? And it's still one of the things that we're trying to look at. We actually, in our Durham, North Carolina site, just got the Bigfoot in June. So looking forward to building out more dyes even for that. And so, you know, why does that matter? And I think this is a really nice example of why it matters, the laser power and how you're looking at that. So you can see here with Q.800 on the Aurora, the primary channel is showing up off the violet laser. And you can see, you know, the other places of cross-excitation, whereas if you're looking at the Bigfoot, the primary channel will be coming off of the UV laser. And that really is just due to the differences in the laser power. And certainly some of our chemists that, you know, have been sort of looking at some of this part of the spectrum, I think one of their complaints was trying to build out something in the UV to balance out the signal with, you know, the UV versus the violet. So things that we spend a lot of time thinking about in dye development. And so just to briefly introduce the Bigfoot, It's, you know, does real-time spectral demixing and sorting at high speeds. You can do multi-way plate sorting. It can have up to 9 lasers and 60 detectors, and you can do spectral or compensation-based sorting. And in terms of the continuous customer feedback, I have been part of the Bigfoot alignment team, and so we constantly also give comments on, you know, parts of the software that we like or don't like. And so this is just showing you the panel building within the Sasquatch software. So you can, it has over 150 fluorophores in the library, and you can also add your own fluorophores. And so, you know, what this is showing here is as you build that out, you can look at the complexity score and in also look at places where the dyes are more similar. So in blue, they're going to be more similar. As you get towards the darker colors, they're less similar. And so, as I mentioned, being part of the Bigfoot alignment team, this is the first round of settings that we're recommending for the Bigfoot. So we went through and tested at various internal sites, so in Durham, Eugene, Carlsbad, and Fort Collins, and tried to, basically in Durham, we would stain cells, send them to the various sites, run them on a certain day, and try to get the best alignment in terms of that. So this is the starting point in terms of those recommendations. And certainly we had a lot of good debates in terms of what was something that we would recommend. So certainly looking forward to feedback, but you can see this is, again, these different instruments, and we have this data available for 30 fluorophores that we ran in these tests. So switching gears yet again, thinking about spectral panel design. In terms of thinking about dyes, you really want to build around cross-excitation and spectral spread by selecting spectrally clean dyes and utilizing that spectral distribution in the panel. And so you can see here, you know, looking at something like cross-excitation, you can see that this is a nice way to sort of look at, you know, as you're building out your panel and planning. You're always sort of planning around dye performance is the truth of the matter. And so it's not always necessarily obvious that, say, BUV-661 would have some cross-excitation into the APC. And so I think this is a helpful way to look at that when you're looking at selecting which dyes. And again, you know, as you're building to that panel, you know, thinking about, okay, am I putting those on cells that would be expressing similar things? So making that harder to unmix or get the resolution in the background. Also looking at spread, so you can see, you know, when you think about these detectors, they are closer together on the Aurora, and so thinking about, you know, am I taking up more space than I need? Should I be using something brighter because I really need that separation, or should I use something dimmer and try to, you know, have just the separation that I need in terms of what's on the panel? And again, thinking about where you're placing those. And so I would say that, you know, it's important to consider if your panel is meant to address broad or deep immune phenotyping. So when we're looking at phenotyping multiple lineages, that's what I would say is a broad panel. So say T cell, B cells, monocyte macrophages. This is a place where you can build around dye performance. And so it's important to, you know, think about, can you position things so that you can build around that problem. In a deeper panel, fewer colors can be used because you're really dealing with co-expression. So something like a T-cell only panel where you have activated CD4 T-cells and T-regs, you really are dealing with issues of co-expression, and so you are going to be more limited by dye performance, so using those cleaner dyes is going to be important. And then panel design is still very much related to dye antibody clone breadth as well as availability. So that's always feedback that I try to provide back to product management is, you know, broadening out what we have available, because you can build the best panel on paper possible, but if you can't get those, you know, antibodies or the dye combination that you want, it doesn't really matter. That's all a theoretical experiment. And you really want to also select dye combinations to minimize the similarity index, looking at the pairwise measure of spectral uniqueness and the complexity score, so the measure of difficulty of the panel to unmix and avoid spectral bunching. And so this is just showing you on the ThermoFisher panel builder. In the dark, you can see those are more similar dyes, and in the yellow, those are less similar or not similar at all. And one of the things that I ran into when I was building out some of the panel, you can see here, you've got BV421, versus super bright 436. It's already a difficult combination. But when you have these closer in the spectral panel, you know, this creates additional issues. So when you're using something like BV421, super bright 436, and E-fluor 450, it leads to a much worse situation in terms of the unmixing. And so one of the interesting things, you know, having looked at my own data, and then I went back to the mathematician and said, you know, we, as I'm building this, I can see the complexity score changing. And so, you know, why is this not telling me that I've made a worse choice as I sort of put that third die in? So if I'm adding these in order, building out that complexity score. And he said, well, the math told you that you actually made the worst choice possible when you put you know, BV421 and super bright 436 together. And so the complexity score did not go up when you put that third item in your panel. And so I was like, well, that's sort of a problem because it implied that there wasn't an issue with me doing that. So just to be aware that that is an issue with the complexity score. And I ran into the same thing with looking at NovaFluor Blue 530 when I added that into this combination where you have FITSI and BB515 that are already 0.98 similar. So just pointing that out, I think there'll be continue to be further math that's developed to help us understand better in terms of panel design, but that was one thing that I noticed was not captured by the math. And so in terms of thinking about the goals for dye selection and spectral panel design, you really want to match antigen density and dyes to provide separation as needed and work to minimize cross-excitation and spread. You want to consider the immune population biology and resolution when building a broad versus deep immune panel to optimize dye performance, because again, you still are dealing with dye performance if you're dealing with populations that are co-expressing there, and making sure you're taking into account, you know, how much separation you need of those populations. That problematic dye combinations are not always identified with just the similarity index and the complexity score. And, you know, in the end, it's not about how many colors, but the resolution of the underlying biology that matters. So I'll end with that. Happy to take any questions, but thanks so much for your time.
Thank you very much, Seddon. Do we have any questions? You get Skittles if you ask a question. Okay. We have to give you a microphone because we're filming it, so let me hand this to you.
Hi. I was just wondering, why is it that the conventional emission and excitation spectra that you can see on vendors' websites, why does that not really represent the true emission characteristics that you would see on a spectral signature?
Yeah, good question. I mean, I think it's just been hard to represent for a long time, and then also one of the opportunities with spectral is having those instruments be, you know, much more similar in terms of, you know, the settings that you're using, and so, you know, when you're running that at a different site, having that look similar. But I do think it's been something that's been missing for a long time. So.
Thank you for your talk. Do you have any plan to make all of these new dyes available for labeling kits? So then we will be able to label our own antibodies.
Yeah, we actually do have conjugation kits for all of these colors. So basically it's just a three-step process where you do the chemistry to add the oligo to the antibody, you do a precipitation step to remove that excess oligo, and then you can do the annealing. And I think one of the advantages of the conjugation kits is you could buy two different ones and even take some small portion of your antibody oligo and then try, say, annealing two different colors. So,
thanks.
Yeah.